actually, I am a Filipina and naturalized citizen. I believe that one's political status should only be determined by the Chamorro people. So to the extent that I am a policymaker, what I think about that is irrelevant. So I just want to pass this on to my colleagues.
For me, I feel that the path of independence is very beneficial for Guam. But I don't think that we should wait for it to happen. I think that we need to start advocating for our rights within the United States now. I think we need to start demanding things, demanding more taxes from them. Last month they had 18,000 military trained there. And all of those tax dollars at Section 30 funding went directly back to their base stations. Most time it's either Hawaii or another state. That money should be funneled back to Guam because they occupy our land, our water, and our airspace. But they don't do that. You know, they take away this right from us and they exploit us. And they, you know, at any given moment, they can take away those that are born here, they can take away their U.S. citizenship. And so this is a very big injustice. I really feel that we need to come together as one Guam and start advocating for these things that are due to us. We can't continue to accept the small breadcrumbs that they've given us since the 1950s. We can't continue to live within the lines of the Organic Act. We can't allow the U.S. to dictate what kind of industries we're going to have. We need to start advocating today. Also, I do believe that because there's a lot of turmoil within the Pacific region, with the neighboring countries such as China and North Korea, I think we need to start taking a very political stance on this. And then demanding that the U.S., you know, hey, what are you going to do? And we need to also empower our own military. Because when we eventually go to independence, we're going to need to have our own state military. We're going to need to have the resources to protect our island. And I say that because I'm in the military. So I think that independence is a very good thing for us. I think that an economic study needs to be done to show that, and we need to start acting on some of the policies and laws that can help us to build a stronger economy for independence, and also to prepare us for military action, especially because of the unrest within the region.
I think Senator was very, very modest. When the question was, what should students do, I can attest to the fact that 40 years ago, and I know I'm giving away my age, but 40 years ago, Nerissa, as a student here at the university, was a spokesperson for those of us that had started the Organization of People for Indigenous Rights. So what she's espousing today is not something that she's just doing for political purposes today. This is something she was doing 40 years ago when she would testify at the legislature for OPIR, pushing for independence and for pushing for self-determination. So this has been something, this has been a fight that she and I have been doing for 40 years. Thanks for, I don't mind telling people our age, but the fact is that this is, all of you have a responsibility. And we're really hoping that you will take up the banner because we're getting old and someone's got to carry the banner. But I just want to attest to the fact that this is not something new for Dr. Senator Underwood. This has been a lifelong fight that she has believed in about the rights of the Chamorro people for self-determination and for the movement for independence. And we've been together in this fight for a long time.
The question was, what would I support? I would support statehood. I would support statehood because I would want full inclusion into the American family, not second-class citizenship that we have right now. There's also the consideration, too, that the U.S. passport is a very powerful document for those of us that want to think about what it does. Seriously, it's the passport that gets you, it's a passport that is get you the fourth highest that would get you into other countries, free to travel to other countries with a visa or a visa upon arrival. I don't know that that's achievable. And if it's not, then we do need to look at another avenue, which is perhaps independence. But what I would offer to the students is, in looking at this issue, don't just take it too lightly. You know, you have to look at what the ramifications are. With statehood, having two senators for Guam and a voting member of the delegate would be incredible. Then our voices are really heard within the American family. But what I would ask you to do is look at what it would mean if you really were to choose the three options, because there is an enormous economic consequence of independence. There is an enormous security consequence with independence. So you have to understand what you are asking for. And I worry you look at our proximity to all these other giants that we have a history of being conquered. That history could repeat itself so easily again unless we are postured in a different way. And we have to be real about that. I worry about that. There was a recent article that if there were a nuclear war, Guam would be one of the safest places in the world to be. Well, yes, we're isolated, but with isolation, and you shake your head, and I understand too, I live right by the Naval Magazine, I know if something happened, I wouldn't even feel it. Good for me, it'd be over before as soon as it started. But there is an article that's out there right now that's circulating, but you know, we have to seriously study this, and I think that the educational process right now is not there. You know, we have to take it upon ourselves, if we're gonna make the vote, know what you're asking for. It's unfortunate where we're at right now. It sickens me where we're at as second-class citizens. It really just sickens the heck out of me. But our choices could be grave, and we really have to be serious about understanding what they are. So, to his point, get involved, and but don't be too naive, because it's far more complicated, and it involves hundreds of years of our history, starting from the trade that we had with the Spaniards and the Dutch coming by here, to the conquest, to the war, to that looming danger that's just between North Korea, China. God help us. You know, we really have to be serious about where we're at and where we could potentially be. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can appreciate my colleagues up here and the answers that they've shared. And I was, as that question was being asked, I was counting on my fingers. How many years have we been trying to determine our political status, how we as an island Guam want to govern ourselves? And when Senator Underwood spoke about right and giving it to the Chamorros, my heart there was a lot of heart for her statement. And then when the Vice Speaker spoke about how many decades, not 10, not 20, not 30, but already 40 years, and we're still at this today. Ladies and gentlemen, if you would ask me this 10 years ago, I would have said without a doubt, I want a closer relationship with the United States. I don't want to lose my United States passport. My husband is in the military. My children, my son is in the military. My family, my brother and sister-in-law are in the military. Why would I want to give that? The freedoms that we live today. Fast forward 12 years, 10 years later, and I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, as Oversight Chair of Tourism, I've had the opportunity to travel to Asia. I've had the opportunity to travel to the United States. I've had the opportunity to at least remember what I learned in school as it relates to civics and government and our history. And I want to say today, without being afraid of where my family is situated today, I saw Dr. Lavaca last week, a week and a half ago, I think, at the Valley of Valadi. And I said, I need to better understand, because my heart compels me choose independence today, as I look at our brothers and sisters from Micronesia having the same seat at the United Nations table that we, as island residents who have a 4,000-year history, taken away from us, not once, not twice, but even 3 times, for that matter, depending on are you talking about Magellan's time? Are you talking about the Spanish time? Are you talking about 1898 when the Spanish sold Guam to the Americans? Are you talking about the Japanese War? And then how the Americans came back and repossessed our island? I mean, we can go all the way back. But can we govern it ourselves? Can we have a relationship? Yes, we can still have a relationship with the United States. But we can also look at how strong we are as an island nation. It is possible. Palau is a population of less than 20,000, if not a little bit more. They probably got all the United States and the islands included, probably just as much outside as there is in Palau. I don't want to say it's honorary Palauan. I am really, really wanting to look of how our people can govern ourselves and continue to have relationships, not just with one country. And that's what each and every one of us in this room have to do tonight. It has been 40 years and we still have not decided. We tried, we came really close to the 70s, but that was denied to us. So I know I'm out of time, but ladies and gentlemen, when we look at resources and we look at understanding and we look at what we're up against, do I think in my heart of hearts that Guam can stand up